will come. We will not confine our marching to Washington. We will march through the South, through the streets of Jackson, through the streets of Danville, through the streets of Cambridge, through the streets of Birmingham. But we will march with the spirit of love and with the spirit of dignity that we have shown here today. By the forces of our demand, our determination, and our numbers, we shall splinter the segregated South into a thousand pieces and put them together in the image of God and democracy. We must say, wake up, America, wake up, for we cannot stop, and we will not and cannot be patient.
Good morning and welcome to worship on this second Sunday in October. This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice. We must rejoice. We have no choice but to rejoice and be glad in it. This is Pastor Mitchell, servant leader here at Trinity AME Zion Church. I'm standing in the Narthex, y'all. This is where I would greet worshipers as they leave, going out to try the realities of an unknown world, things that are facing them. I would greet them right back here. And of course, there's no one here on the campus. There's no one here in the space. Trinity, I miss you terribly. But I thank and praise God that we are doing what is prudent and practical for your safety, our safety, and our survival. So come on, join us as we worship this morning, as we praise God for another day's journey. Praise God for another week. Look forward to a mighty word coming to us this morning as we continue to navigate through these new spaces that I believe God is giving us the strength to tunnel through. You'll see announcements regarding what's happening here in our local church. You'll see what we're doing. I want to thank our missionaries and those who are providing food and assistance for this particular region where we are situated. Thank you, Sister Bakeman. Thank you, Outreach Ministry. Thank you, Food Pantry Ministry, Sister Dolly Robinson, and all those who are working to make sure that we take care of the least of these. Listen, you know what I'm going to tell you. It's important that we vote. Early voting begins October 15th here in this area. And I'm encouraging you, strongly urging you, let's get it done. Let's make it happen. Let's vote like our lives depend on it. Because the truth is, friends, our lives depend on us making the right decisions, getting up, being proactive, and voting. Let's take care of that. Let's handle business, y'all. We can do it. We've done it before. We can do it again. I urge you to continue supporting our ministry here as we continue to reach and touch lives. Members of Trinity, we're asking you to please consider, if you have not already, consider tithes and offerings as the way that we take care of the Lord's work. Thank you, friends, for sharing with us this morning. I want to pray that God blesses your day. All of the other announcements will be on at the end of service. Let me pray that God will bless your day, bless your week, bless your lives. Let me also pray that God will bless you as you step out on faith to give in support of this work here at Trinity Church. God, we come in Jesus' name and we thank you and praise you for this another day. Thank you for this second Sunday in October. God, you've spared our lives, and for that we give you thanks and praise. Thank you, God, for what you're doing, what you have done, and what you will continue to do in us and through us. Bless every gift and every giver. Bless those who are listening to us this morning. May they be blessed by this worship, word, and witness. And may your glory, your Shekinah glory, rest on their homes and on their lives. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Jesus.
My hiding place. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. I'll be reading from the Common English Version. Hear now what the Spirit is saying to the church. And after a few days, Jesus went back to Capernaum, and people heard that he was at home. So many gathered that there was no longer space, not even near the door. And Jesus was speaking the word to them. Some people arrived, and four of them were bringing to him a man who was paralyzed. They couldn't carry him through the crowd, so they tore off part of the roof above where Jesus was. And when they had made an opening, they lowered the mat on which the paralyzed man was lying. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Child, your sins are forgiven." Now, some legal experts were sitting there muttering among themselves, "Why does he speak in this way? He's insulting God. Only the one God can forgive sins." Jesus immediately recognized what they were discussing, and he said to them, "Why do you fill your minds with these questions? Which is easier, to say to a paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take up your bed, and walk'? But so you will know that the human one has authority on the earth to forgive sins," he said to the man who was paralyzed, "Get up, take your mat, and go home." And then Jesus raised him up, and right away he picked up his mat and walked out in front of everybody. They were all amazed and praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. It is an honor to be here today. And first, before I begin, I really just want to begin by commending all of you at Trinity for the ways that you have stepped up and adapted during this time of social distancing. These days and these months have been an opportunity for growth for many congregations, learning how to hold meetings and Bible studies by Zoom, transitioning to online worship, engaging with each other in more virtual ways. You've accepted that challenge, and you've done it well. Still, I know that there are many of you awaiting the day that we can all return to this sanctuary to be here to hear the word preached in the flesh. And although we don't know when that will happen, we do anticipate that day coming soon. And so imagine if during that homecoming for us, that return to the sanctuary, if it went anything like the story we heard from Mark today. The crowd gathered around, listening, expecting Jesus speaking, probably riffing on his major theme, "The kingdom of God is near, repent and believe the good news." And as he's speaking and the words fall from his lips, little flecks of dust began to fall from the ceiling. Then some tiles here and there, long splinters of wood and big rough shingles, until finally a gaping hole, part of the roof, had crumbled around them. Some people were up there pushing their way through, the Greek says plucking, tearing an opening through which they lowered a paralyzed man slowly right into the middle of the room for all to see. In the pastorates I've served, I've handled and had to deal with a number of building issues and emergencies, and so I'd imagine that if that happened here, the trustees are going to have something to say about it. But it's interesting to me the way that Jesus responded. Jesus, I think, was very good at improvisation. I heard a story once about Wynton Marsalis, the great jazz trumpeter. He was playing a gig one night, and in the middle of one of the songs, someone's cell phone started to ring, which could have been disastrous, but Wynton didn't stop. He didn't miss a beat. He started playing the sound and the tune from the ringtone on his trumpet, and finally resolved into the original melody. He made that interruption part of the song. And that's what Jesus did that day. He turned this interruption into part of the message. Remember, he's preaching about the beloved community. And in the beloved community, it is often the last ones you'd expect who get counted among the faithful. In that parable of the laborers in the vineyard, who is it who gets paid first? The ones who showed up late to work. And they get paid the same amount as everyone else. And in the parable of the prodigal, who is it that gets the banquet in the end? The son who stayed home and worked and did all the things he was supposed to do? No. The one who ran off and squandered his inheritance. Well, here today, the ones who destroyed the property, the ones who pushed through, they're the faithful ones. And in response, when he saw their faith, Jesus said to the paralytic, "Child, your sins are forgiveness." But why? Why forgiveness? It is well documented throughout the Bible that certain conditions were considered to be the result of sinfulness, but it's not always clear that that's what Jesus thinks. In John, for instance, when Jesus and his disciples encountered a blind man, the disciples asked him, "Teacher, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus said, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that the glory of God might be revealed in him." But I bet some in that crowd were asking that same question about the man in front of him, so focused on his condition that they could not see a person, but a mysterious other, someone who was to be overlooked and rejected, cast out. Maybe Jesus felt the same way. Or maybe Jesus sees him like he sees all of us when we've been pushed out and dehumanized by the world, as a person needing to know that they are loved and embraced as they are. Jesus' actions and his words, as we heard, run counter to what some of the legal scholars in the room thought. Listen to the questions they asked. Why does this man speak in this way? He offends God. Only God can forgive sins. And according to their way of thinking, forgiveness was a role of the priest. Only certain people had access to God. Only certain people could atone for the sins of God. But Jesus knows that when people need reconciliation, when they need to know that they are loved and embraced, when they need to know that there is atonement, when they need to know that healing is possible, they need to know now. And so Jesus said, "The human one has the authority to forgive sins on earth." And as the proof, he performed the very earthy, physical miracle of a healing. "Stand up," he said to the paralytic, "take your mat and go to your home." It was an interruption for everyone. But when his friends pushed through, a man was healed. But why did they have to push through in the first place? Well, the text says that the crowd that gathered was so great that no one had any room for anyone else, not even in front of the door. And so that paralyzed man and his friends had been physically crowded out, which is surprising to me because I assume they tried to enter through the main passageways. And I was taught that when you see someone who might need a little extra help, who might need a little extra time to get in, then you clear out a little space for them, even help them if you can. But apparently in this passage, the people inside did not or would not make room for him. Sometimes we have to do that. We see that in our justice work. Sometimes when we try the more civil means, the usual means, the means that you're supposed to make a difference, to get in, we find instead that we have to interrupt. We have to push our way through. And I wonder then, who are the people that we crowd out today? Is it the millions of people living in poverty and low wealth? Is it the tens of millions of people without access to health care? Is it the women abused and used up by the system of patriarchy? Is it those who are facing racism and the persistent threat of voter suppression? Is it those affected not only by their sentences, but after release from the prison industrial complex? Is it the millions of people like this paralyzed man affected by our ableism every day? Is it the immigrants whose land we stole in the first place? And then have the audacity to talk about building a wall. If the structures we have built are so narrow that they do not allow people access to healing and justice and a liberated life, then those structures must come down. And therefore, like the friends of that paralyzed man, we got to push through. We hear the echoes of this throughout the scriptures. Ecclesiastes, for everything there's a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to plant and to pluck up what was planted, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow. And it was in the call of Jeremiah, so today I appoint you over nations, to pluck up and pull down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. Paul said it well to that church in Ephesus. God has broken down the dividing wall that is the hostility between us. And so God seemed to be on a mission and involves us in a mission of breaking down and pushing through and tearing down those systems that make it hard and even impossible for healing to happen. And so what does that work look like for us today? In case you haven't heard, the election is here. Across the nation, over 1 million people and counting have already cast their vote by absentee ballot. In some states, early voting has already begun. It will begin here in North Carolina this week. And the final outcome over this election hangs over this nation, just like that roof in this story. I am not exaggerating when I say that this may be the most consequential election to date in my lifetime. We've had some historic ones for sure, but this election is consequential not only because of who is at the top of the ticket, but the outcome of that day will either create some openings for change or entrench some obstacles that will impact us for decades to come. Justice is on this ballot, and you already heard from the passage the way legal scholars can be an obstacle, and you're already familiar by now with the controversy over the Supreme Court nominee, a nominee who I happen to share an alma mater with. The decision to move forward with the confirmation so close to this election and what that could mean for women's ability to make decisions about their bodies, for health care, for marriage equality, for voting rights, potentially a decision on the election itself. And not only the national Supreme Court, but all and many federal judgeships across the nation are at stake. Need I remind you that in North Carolina, when the legislature passed the monster voter suppression law, it was the federal courts who ruled it illegal and constitutional, saying it targeted black people with surgical precision. North Carolina A&T State University is now finally a whole campus, united under one congressional district instead of being split into two. And that happened because the courts were there to roll back the egregious racial and political gerrymandering we have seen in this state, seeking to solidify the power of one party and dilute the power of the people. Justice is on this ballot, y'all. We must push through. And questions about the continued impact of white supremacy are on the ballot. White supremacy, racism, these are nothing new and they aren't going away anytime soon. But in this election, we face a decision between whether we will continue to allow white supremacy and racism to shape public policy or be guided by the lessons that so many have finally woken up to this year around how pervasive racism is. Yes, it targets black and brown and indigenous people, but its implications at the policy level are destructive for everyone. The other day, Dr. William Barber said it well, if you scratch a racist, you will find a thief. If you scratch a racist, you'll find someone who'll steal health care for black and white folk and brown folk. If you scratch a racist, you'll find someone who'll steal living wages for white folk and black folk and indigenous and Latino. And still, for so long, so many people in this country have chosen the regressive policies of white supremacy, calling it patriotism, not realizing they are undermining themselves. But with the awakening that is happening, we have an opportunity in this election to say, we won't stand back and we won't stand by. We're going to push through. We're going to pull down old structures. And I like how Isaiah says it in the Message version, use that old rubble, those old stones, those old monuments, those old buildings, those old structures of past lives to build anew, rebuild the foundations from our past. And then we will be known as the people who can fix anything, who can restore old ruins, rebuild and renovate and make the community livable again. Now, I'm not naive. I know that this won't happen in one election cycle. And I am familiar with the debate about whether voting even matters. And I'm not going to shame anyone who thinks otherwise, but I do believe that voting is at least a tactic to get us there. And I like how a friend of mine says that. She says, voting rearranges the terrain upon which we struggle. The struggle will continue, but we have a choice about whether we're going to watch from afar and hope everything turns out all right, or will we help to push through the obstacles? This week, I have been inspired by the example of some people who push through. One of them is an ancestor in the movement, Fannie Lou Hamer. This past Tuesday would have been her 103rd birthday. And do you remember all the work she did registering and turning people out to vote in Mississippi, even at the risk of her own body and health and life and her job? Even establishing the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party in opposition to the Democratic Party there who wanted the black vote but refused to listen to black voices. She and others traveled all the way up to Atlantic City, New Jersey to be seated as the official delegation from Mississippi at the Democratic Convention that year. And when they tried to compromise with her, giving her only two seats, she refused to compromise, saying, "We didn't come here for no two seats. We're all tired. We came here for democracy." Through her years, she risked it all. She pushed through for us. And so, as timing would have it, on her birthday this year, the city council here in Greensboro finally did the right thing after a tireless, uncompromising 41-year struggle by some to have the city acknowledge its role in a massacre right here in this city. You may know the details. November 3rd, 1979. A group was organizing a march that started at Morningside Homes. The march was in support of textile workers, helping to unionize them, demanding that the city and the county and the state and the nation address poverty and racism. The marchers were ambushed by members of the Ku Klux Klan. Five of them died. And it was later discovered that there was collusion between the Greensboro City Police and the Klan. The Klan was given information on exactly where the marchers would be, and there was no police protection to be found for them. In fact, the police had demanded that the protesters themselves be unarmed. And after 41 years of denials, of half apologies, and refusals to make amends, the city council on Tuesday finally issued an apology saying, "The City Council of the City of Greensboro hereby expresses its apology to the victims, the survivors, their families, and the members of the Morningside Homes community for the events that occurred there, and the failure of any government action to effectively overcome the hate that precipitated the violence, to embrace the sorrow that resulted from the violence, and to reconcile all the vestiges of those heinous events in the years subsequent to 1979. I don't know what these words mean for those who lost their friends, their spouses, their loved ones that day. I don't know what it means for those who survived but witnessed the things that took place that day. But I see in these words an opening made for us by those who refused to compromise, who pushed through, and now we have the opportunity as a city to build and to heal from the pain of the past. The calling to continue that work is on all of us. We have a calling to make openings for those who've been crowded out and ignored, and we have the power to do so because, like that man that day, we have been embraced as children of God. And in case you are too afraid or think you are too powerless or too inadequate, let me remind you of some words that I sometimes have to tell myself when I can't find the strength to push through. You are a child of God, and God loves you as you are. God knows the goodness within you, the faults you hide, and all you can become. God's love is strong. It held us when we cried at birth, sustains us now, and will surround us when we breathe our last. And so live in your hopes, not in your fears, walking in the light of the Lord. Amen.
Wow, what a word. Thank God for the word and for the preacher. And my prayer is that that word blessed you in a major way. We never close our worship without giving you an opportunity to receive Christ. So that person who needs a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, if you would simply reach out to us, you can email us or you can call us. The information will be on your screen. We'd love to usher you into a savoring relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Or if you're looking for a church home, and it doesn't matter where you live on the planet, we'd be glad to have you as a part of our eChurch family. Simply reach out to us, call us, write us, email us. We'll be glad to have you as a part of our family. My prayer is that you will continue to have a powerful, positive, and productive week as you continue to live life with purpose and on purpose. And until we gather again in space together, the Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of God's countenance upon you and give you peace, now, henceforth, and forevermore. And the blessed people of God said, amen, amen. Amen. God bless you. I love you. Stay safe. Wear your mask. Register to vote. Make sure you take care of yourselves. I love you. Peace.